hand, let me go. Team SAT is here to present a research highlighting the dilemma of bioethics with respect to euthanasia among medical fraternity. Over to Team SAT.
Every morning is a battle to get ready for the day. Every afternoon is a struggle to stay awake. Every night is a fight to fall asleep. This is the sad reality of Mr. Venkatesh, a 6-year-old maid suffering from amyotrophic lateral sclerosis.
Hi Venkatesh, how are you doing this morning?
Things have worsened progressively, doctor. I'm paralyzed, can't eat, move or breathe. Suffering with no hope of recovery. This isn't living, it's a mere existence. And I want to end it.
Hold my hand.
Let me go.
Does a patient have the right to choose his death? What does a doctor do? Would he euthanize a patient? Is euthanasia ethical? Is it legal? A dilemma of medical ethics. There may be some developments in the legal status of euthanasia in our country. Yet we do not know to what extent the Indian doctors and medical students ethically accept euthanasia. Ultimately, it is the doctor who has to euthanize the patient. So, through our study, we aim to assess the awareness and attitudes towards euthanasia among medical undergraduates, postgraduates, and clinicians in India, the factors responsible, and compare their knowledge and attitudes in this regard.
We conducted a cross-section study through a self-structured questionnaire sent to Google Forms after taking ethics committee approval. Using the Cochrane's formula, the sample size was calculated to be 480. We received 333 filled responses with a response rate of 69%. Through our study, we found out that although 85% know what euthanasia is, 15% are still not aware of it.
So, what is euthanasia? The British House of Lords Committee on Medical Ethics defines euthanasia as a deliberate intervention undertaken with the express intention of ending a life to relieve intractable suffering. Based on the person giving the informed consent, it can be divided into three types: voluntary, non-voluntary, and involuntary. Voluntary, when the patient makes a plea for a life-terminating process. Non-voluntary, when the explicit consent of the patient is unavailable, as in cases of coma and persistent vegetative state. Involuntary, when performed against the will of the patient. It is illegal everywhere. Each of these can be further subdivided into active and passive. Active euthanasia refers to the physician's deliberate act, usually by administration of lethal drugs, to end a terminally ill patient's life. Passive euthanasia entails the withholding of the treatment necessary for the continuance of life.
Where did euthanasia actually begin? The idea that death can be merciful is not new. Euthanasia dates back to ancient Greece and Rome. The use of morphine and anesthetics to intentionally end a patient's life was first proposed in the 19th century, and this led to the belief that a less painful dying process was possible. Netherlands was the first country to legalize euthanasia in 2001. Today, euthanasia is legally practiced in the Netherlands, Belgium, Luxembourg, Colombia, and Canada. What is the current status of euthanasia in India?
When asked about the legal status of euthanasia in our country, 70% of the participants didn't know that passive euthanasia is legal. In 2018, the Supreme Court in a landmark judgment declared the right to die with dignity as a fundamental right, while observing that the right to die in peace could not be separated from the right to life under Article 21. It was Aruna's case which sparked the debate over euthanasia laws in India.
Aruna Ramchandra Sharma was a staff nurse working at King Edward Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. On November 27, 1973, she was assaulted by a ward boy and was strangulated with a chain that cut off oxygen supply to her brain, leaving her deaf, blind, paralyzed, and in a persistent vegetative state. In 2009, Pinky Virani, a social activist, approached the Supreme Court as a next friend, arguing that continued existence of Aruna is in violation of her right to live with dignity. However, KM Hospital filed a counter petition. In March 2011, the Apex Court concluded that the staff at KM Hospital was considered as next friend, dismissing the Virani's plea of their wish for Aruna to be allowed to live. However, they had the option of withdrawing life support if they changed their mind. She was in persistent vegetative state for 42 years until she died in 2015 of pneumonia.
After a long period of ambiguity and debate, passive euthanasia became a reality in India in 2018 under strict guidelines. That is, when a patient is either in a persistent vegetative state or terminal. 2004. Post verdict, in the hearing of Common Cause versus Union of India, the Apex Court concluded that a person of competent mental faculty, as judged by a team of three doctors, is entitled to execute an advance medical directive.
When asked about Union, we found out that almost 40% of the participants knew about it, 32.5% heard of it, and 28% were unaware. What is living will? Based on the principle of autonomy, living will is a written statement attested by two witnesses and a judicial magistrate, wherein a person is in a healthy state of mind, voluntarily specifies his desires regarding future medical treatment and life-saving measures in circumstances where they are no longer able to express informed consent. When such a circumstance arises, the treating physician shall discuss it with the family and check for the authenticity of the living will if present. With the notice of the treating physician, the hospital creates a medical book constituting the head of the treating department and at least three expert doctors with 20 years of working experience to decide withdrawal of the medical treatment.
If the medical board certifies that the will can be carried out, the hospital informs the collector, who then immediately constitutes another medical board comprising of the chief district medical officer and three expert doctors. The medical board examines the patient. All the aspects they satisfy, the board shall convey their decision to the judicial magistrate, who then visits the patient, and after assessing all the facts, the court may permit to give the medical directive.
The aims of our systemic research in understanding the balance between exhausting treatment and a dignified death were achieved by inquiring about the participants' experiences, knowledge and attitude. We analyzed the collected data using the SPSS software. Chi-square test was used to interpret the associations between categorical variables. P-value of less than 0.05 is considered significant.
More than 50% of the clinicians and postgraduates encountered situations where the patients asked them to hasten their deaths. When asked if they would perform euthanasia on terminally ill patients, we came across few interesting results. We saw that the majority of the participants said they would perform passive euthanasia, but there was only a narrow gap between those who preferred passive euthanasia and those who opted for not performing euthanasia at all. Only very few participants said they would perform active euthanasia, and majority of them were identified as undergraduates.
Majority of the participants have come across deaths, although some have close to terminal illness during their practice. It was surprising to note that it did not have any significant impact on their opinion to perform euthanasia.
In our study, when the participants were asked whether they would consider euthanasia as an option for terminally ill patients, 3/4 of the participants said yes, while most strongly opposed the idea of it. There was no significant difference in the opinion among undergraduates, postgraduates, and clinicians.
When the participants were asked reasons for supporting euthanasia, majority opted for unbearable nature of treatment, leading to no improvement, followed by patients' right to die with dignity. Most of them were of the opinion that it can be performed for patients in a persistent vegetative state or coma, followed by patients suffering from terminal illness. Not many considered severe intellectual disabilities as an important reason for termination of life.
The remaining 1/4 that opposed euthanasia do so mainly due to cases of untimely depression and suicidal ideations. Other significant reasons were fear of misuse and religious beliefs. 2 out of 3 participants stated that their religious beliefs did not influence their opinion on euthanasia. However, on chi-square analysis, we found a significant relationship between religion and attitude, thus rejecting the null hypothesis.
In a situation where the patient's explicit consent is unavailable, majority of the participants were of the opinion that immediate family followed by the treating clinician as the most eligible decision makers to authorize euthanasia.
The various aspects of euthanasia should be taught and discussed during the clinical years of the medical.
your opinion. If it is yes, why? If it is no, why?
Ma'am, as a team, we are neutral because all of our teammates have diverse opinions. Personally, I do not have a strong opposition or strong support towards euthanasia. I believe that in certain conditions, euthanasia is probably should be considered as an option at least, but in other conditions, it might not be fit.
As a team, we have various opinions, ma'am. But my personal opinion is that passive euthanasia can be considered as ethical. However, there need to be very strict regulations in place to prevent the misuse.
So congratulations for bringing up this topic, a very relevant topic. What's the way forward? Because euthanasia can be misused as well. I mean, family members may not want a person to be there, an elderly person for that matter. So how do you put the stops in place? What's the way forward from your side?
Thank you for the question, ma'am. So this has been a major concern of many of the participants as well, because there is a large scope for misuse. So the law, the Supreme Court has published a law commission which clearly states that if a person in an incompetent state and their family members want euthanasia, the doctor is not allowed to perform on family members' wishes. They are supposed to approach the court, and the judge of the High Court will act as a parent of the patient and will think in the best interest of the patient after assessing both sides and will give the final decision. And the doctor will not be penalized for this. So this is a strict legal procedure which many of us are not aware of, which the Supreme Court has placed to prevent misuse and also protect the doctors as well.
So I think absolutely right. So this is what you need to highlight, because this has come as a recent judgment and many of the practicing physicians are also not aware of it. So how to go about it? So is euthanasia now legal in India?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, so that message has to go across, right?
Good question, ma'am. In 2018, the Supreme Court legalized passive euthanasia. As of now, there is no law in place. But until there is a law, the High Court will take care of all the legal procedures. As of now, passive euthanasia is legal, but there is no law regulating the procedure. And active euthanasia is strictly illegal, and any types of physician-assisted suicide are also illegal in India as of now.
Like till the Parliament passes a bill, the Supreme Court has taken it in its hands, and whatever the rules they have placed will be followed till the Parliament has passed it.
So writing DNR in patient's case sheet is perfectly okay. DNR, do not resuscitate, is that okay?
So ma'am, DNR and like advanced directive, which is a part of euthanasia, are two completely different terms. The recent ICMR guidelines have